I have shown already that since our brush with the tanner, we berthed the car each night at some different place. But Mansell was not satisfied with this precaution, and presently determined that the relief should always begin at 11 o'clock, and that from 10 o'clock onwards, one of the four in the dungeon should watch as much as he could of the opposite shore. This may appear to have been an idle exercise, because the sentry was too distant to see or hear any movement which was made in the danger zone, and I must confess that I did not myself account it worth the expense of a workman, for nowadays we laboured to all hours. But Mansell had given the order, and so it was done. We had always kept in the dungeon a supply of tinned food, sufficient to last us some days, but this stock we now increased, until, if the worst came to pass, we could live for full 3 weeks without leaving the oubliette. However, the day went by, and no one troubled us. If the tanner watched us again, we never saw him. The soil at the foot of the gutter was sometimes drenched, but never the marsh we had made it. And while the enemy's labour was fitful, and they had, I think, no concerted plan of action except to deny us the well, we continued to drive forward with all our might. And here, let me say that we were by now the owners of Wagensburg, for Ellis had let go his option, and Mansell had purchased the place. But I doubt if seigneury was ever so strangely enjoyed, the freeholders having their being like rats in the bowels of the earth, and in constant dread of their presence being observed, and their enemies in possession, and coming and going and doing just as they pleased. It was 13 days to an hour since Tester had bade the tanner, and Bell and I were engaged at the nose of the shaft when I heard someone running towards us, and the next moment Rowley's voice. Hanbury desired me, he said, to come to the gallery at once. Leaving Bell to put out the searchlight and follow me down, I immediately left for the gallery, making what haste I could. But after the glare of the lamp, I was as good as blind, and the light of the candles which were burning in the shaft and the oubliette was too feeble to guide my steps. However, at last I was down, to find Hanbury at the middle embrasure, peering into the night. His report was disquieting indeed. "There's someone across the river. I saw the flash of a torch." I do not think either of us doubted that the fat was now in the fire, for that anyone but one of the thieves would be using an electric torch about the quarry, or indeed for 20 miles round, was most improbable. The time was 10:30, and Mansell was due to arrive at 11 o'clock. Now where he would berth the rolls we could not tell, beyond that it would be at some place within 500 yards of the spot we had used as a key. But since there were but two roads, the one running south from Villach and into the other, which followed the river along, for the thieves to mark her arrival would be most easy. And once they had seen her stop and her occupants separate, the most maladroit attack could hardly fail. There was therefore but one thing to do, namely to try to reach Mansell before the rolls had entered the danger zone. And since he was always punctual, yet never hurried, it was perfectly plain that if we were to be in time, we had not one moment to lose. In a twinkling, our plans were laid. Hanbury, who was a good runner, was to make the attempt. Having swum the river and landed a little downstream, he was to strike across country and head for the Villach Road. Bell and I were to follow, but when we had crossed the river, we should approach the quarry and try to locate the thieves, so that if Hanbury failed, at least we should be able to offer some other support. Rowley was to be left in charge of the oubliette. Hanbury was gone in an instant, for he was lightly clad and waited for nothing. But for Bell and me to go unarmed would have been idle, and since we must wrap up our pistols to save them from getting wet, we stripped and did the same with our clothes before descending the chute. We were soon across the water, and having made the bank at a place where a gurgling brook ran into the river, were able to dress in its gully without much apprehension of being heard. Indeed, the night itself was an invisible cloak. I never remember darkness so impenetrable, and there was not a breath of air. I then did my best to consider what manner of ambush the thieves would determine to lay, but could only decide that the track which led to the quarry and the junction of the two roads were, for the moment, the two most probable points. We therefore crossed the road and began to move towards the junction, in the hope of hearing some sound which would help us to a better understanding of what was afoot. The track which led to the quarry ran out of the Villach Road. We had come, so far as I could judge, to within 15 yards of the junction, when I heard the murmur of a voice a little way off. I at once stood still, the better to hear whence it came, but even as I did so, it ceased. After straining my ears in vain, I went cautiously on, to be instantly checked by a rope, stretched breast-high across the road, and stout enough to stop or disable a car that sought to pass by. This discovery shook me, for it showed that the thieves not only knew what to expect, but intended to take no chance of losing their prey. However, I was thankful to have made it, and since Bell had with him his knife, we immediately severed the rope and let it lie. It now seemed certain that if we went on, past the junction, we should come to another rope, for to bar but one of the two doors would have been out of reason. It was also equally clear that we had now come to the verge of the danger zone, and that this lay roughly triangular about the junction, with its base running directly from rope to rope, and its apex lying somewhere upon the Villach road. Since I had no plan of action, to open the road, if we could, seemed plainly the first thing to do, and with this intent, we picked our way to the river and started to hug its edge in order to give the junction as wide a berth as we could. We had reached a point opposite the junction, and from where I was standing, I could see the pale smear which the Villach road made upon the black of the night, when I felt Bell's fingers close upon my arm. I suppose his grip was telltale, for though he breathed no word, in that instant I certainly knew that the worst had happened, and that Hanbury had lost his race. So we stood, still as death, for 5 seconds. Then I heard the brush of a tire as it rounded a hairpin bend. I have heard it said that though the approach of a crisis is apt to scatter the wits, its sudden descent will sometimes whip them back into a battle array. So it was with me at that moment, for though for a quarter of an hour I had been groping feverishly, my disorder suddenly left me, and I saw as clear as daylight what I must do. At once I drew my pistol and fired twice across the road. I thought the consequent din would never die, but at last the echoes faded, and we were able to listen for lesser sounds. The rolls had stopped. Now, though we had ruined the ambush, there was still the devil to pay, for I knew the way was too narrow to let the rolls go about, and that to reverse in such darkness along so crooked a road was out of the question. But it suddenly came to my mind that if Mansell were to switch on his headlights and run for it towards Lerai, that is to say, turn to the left at the junction, we should be out of the wood, for the thieves would almost certainly suffer the car to go by in the full expectation that she would be wrecked by the rope. I therefore decided to join Mansell as quickly as ever I could, and whispering to Bell to follow, hastened across the foreshore and onto the road. Pitch dark though it was, I dared not go directly by way of the Villach road, and we had just started back towards Lerai when I heard the deep breath of an engine, and then the rolls coming with the rush of a mighty wind. Mansell had divined the best course, and was making his dash. And all would be well, provided he turned to the left. If at the junction he turned to the right instead. I know that for one long moment my heart stood still. Then, throwing caution to the winds, Bell and I turned and raced for the second rope. The junction was now bright as day, and the car was so close that had there been nothing to gain, I should not have crossed its path, but have waited for it to go by. I found myself praying that Mansell would turn to the left. As he swooped at the corner, I ran clean into the rope, but the rolls was round and coming before I had opened Bell's knife. I slashed at the rope like a madman, but before I could cut it right through, the car swept by and, ripping it out of my hand, mercifully snapped asunder such strands as were left. As we ran in the wake of the rolls, I heard an ejaculation and then a spurt of high words, but though I was sure I heard Ellis, I could not distinguish Rose Noble's voice. The rolls had vanished, and I was beginning to wonder whether it would not be wiser to let Bell go on while I returned to see what the thieves were doing and if I could meet Hanbury, when Mansell rose out of the shadows and spoke my name. I told him my tale. "I'm much obliged," he said quietly. "You are up against time in the thieves, and you beat them both. When I am so placed, I hope I shall do as well. I think it likely that Hanbury missed his way. It's very hard to go straight on a night like this, and that's why we must get back. Your shots will bring them to the junction, and we don't want an accident. With that, he showed us the boat and the sculls in a ditch and proposed to take to the water and scull downstream. "For the way of a river," said he, "is swift and safe and silent, and I was a fool not to have used it before." In this he was unfair to himself, for the relief nowadays took up the best part of an hour, four water journeys having to be made each night, and if these journeys had been considerably lengthened, we should have been worn out before we could get to bed. Then he told us that the Rolls was gone and would not come back that way, but that Carson had orders to be at the culvert at 3, and if no one of us came before 4 o'clock, to return to Salzburg. Before he went, he would leave a note wedged in the brickwork to say he was safe, and when 24 hours had gone by, he would come there again. So he would continue to do until one of us came to meet him, or he found a note under the arch. "And now for Hanbury," said Mansell, "and then for the oubliette." We slipped down the river noiselessly, and when we approached the bend, at a signal from Mansell, Bell, who was rowing, rested upon his oars. We could hear no sound at all, and after drifting for a moment, Mansell whispered to Bell to head for the chute. So thick was the darkness that Bell, not unnaturally, sculled to the side of the stream, and when he could make out the bank, began to follow this down. We had just passed the slope of the woods and come to the cliff, when a torch was flashed twice from the bank 5 paces away. Before we could think, came 2 flashes from the opposite side. And that was all. At once, Bell lay on his oars, but after listening intently, Mansell bade him scull for the chute. Almost at once we were there, and Mansell put up a hand and rang the bell. So soon as the flap was lifted, "Listen, Rowley," says Mansell, putting his mouth to the chute, "is Mr. Hanbury with you?"
"No, sir."
"Have you anything to report?"
2 flashes a moment ago, sir, but nothing else."
Mansell turned to me.
"William," he said, "I don't think we're out of the wood. To be perfectly honest, I'm altogether at sea. I know neither what to do nor what to think, but what bothers me most of all is where is Rose Noble? That being so, I'd rather you held the fort. So you go up and send Rowley down to me, and then we'll go and find George."
I did not at all relish the prospect of garrison duty at such a time, for if trouble was coming, to be mewed up within sound of the skirmish would be well nigh unbearable. But since I had nothing to plead but my own reluctance, I stripped with what haste I could, and 2 minutes later Rowley had taken my place. The night was so dark and so still that for a moment I thought the windows were shuttered, and was stupidly astonished to find the timbers gone. And when I looked out, I might have been gazing into a bottomless pit. However, I took my seat in the middle embrasure, and cupping my chin in my palm, stared resolutely into the darkness, with my ears pricked to gather the faintest sound. But all I could hear was the regular lap of the water against the face of the cliff. It had all along been in my mind that Mansell and Hanbury would cross, and when, but a short 5 minutes after the former had left, the bell from the chute announced the latter's return, I was less surprised than provoked by this well-worn trick of fortune. For there was Mansell gone out on a sleeveless errand into the midst of some danger he could not read, and that at a time when the last thing we needed to do was to play the spy, and everything was to be gained by lying close below ground. However, the milk was spilt, and since to tread water is a laborious exercise, I lost no time in setting aside the flap and letting the ladder down. It was immediately clear that George was very near spent, for when I called to him he had not the breath to answer, and when at last he was fairly upon the ladder, he hung there, panting, like a dog on a sultry day. I asked if I should come down, but he took no notice, and after a little while he began to ascend. I was alarmed by his demeanour, which was that of the survivor of some catastrophe, and squatting down at the head of the ladder, reached up my hands to help him out of the chute. Now I had intended to set my hands under his arms, but the moment I touched him he threw an arm round my neck. To save myself from falling, I instinctively flung myself back, and since in that instant he heaved, the 2 of us fell down together onto the flags. "Thanks very much," said Rose Noble. Then I felt the mouth of a pistol pressed tight against my throat. I can never describe the disgust and the horror I felt. But the brain is a curious member, and as I lay there on the pavement, with the bulk of his body upon me, I could not help thinking that Rose Noble's ascent of the chute was a remarkable feat for a man of his corpulent habit, and wondering how he had made it without the support of an oath. He was lightly clad, but the clothes he was wearing were drenched, and the absurd conceit that I was in the clutches of some aquatic monster was most repugnant. Nevertheless, I had the sense to lie still, and after a little, Rose Noble got to his knees. For a moment he fumbled, then the bright eye of a torch illumined the chamber. At this my heart leapt up, for had he desired to appraise Mansell of his entry, he could not have found a surer or swifter way, for all three windows were open, and their sudden radiance was bound to publish my plight. Rose Noble got to his feet and bade me do the same. I was glad to obey. Then he stepped back and looked about him. "So," he said after a while. Then he leaned forward and spoke down the chute. "Bunch?"
"Hello?" said Bunch from below. "You saw me ring that bell?"
"Yes," said Bunch.
"Fetch Ellis and Job over here. When you're back, ring three times."
"Righto." Rose Noble straightened his back. "Pull up that ladder," he said.
"Not on your life," said I. "You've come to the wrong house." I could hardly see him, for the light was full in my face, but I felt his eyes upon mine.
At length he took a deep breath. Then, "Stand back," he said thickly. I did so, folding my arms. At once he straddled the chute, and putting the torch in his teeth, with his free hand felt for the ladder and pulled it up. Then he picked up the flap and sank this into its place. This show of strength surprised me, for the flap was very heavy, and I would never have believed that a man so fat and flabby could have made light of such a task. Rose Noble took the torch from his mouth and leaned his back against the wall. "When Ellis comes," said he, "I shall ask you to show us around. I like to think that you will grant that request." I said nothing, and after a moment he continued slowly enough. "Nobody likes getting stuck. But when he's stuck good and proper, the wise guy swallows his dose. And now listen to me, you young fool. I've taken possession here, and here I stay. So long as I stay, Mansell will remain outside. He's very welcome to get up that drain, if he can, but short of the ladder, I don't believe he'll try. If he wants the well, he can have it. But I rather fancy he'll be thinking more about you. They say blood's thicker than water." "Well, he's welcome to think. If he asks me, I haven't seen you. I found the ladder waiting and came right up."
"Do you think he'll believe you?" said I.
"Why not?" said Rose Noble. I had no answer to make, for as I spoke I saw the force of his words. Here truth was stranger than fiction, and Mansell would never believe that I had handed him in.
"And so," said Rose Noble quietly, "I guess we can count Mansell out."
"Don't you believe it," said I. "He's made rings round you in the past, and he'll do it again."
"Maybe he will," said Rose Noble. "But unless and until he does, I reckon it's up to you."
"Indubitably," said I. Rose Noble sighed.
"No fool like a young fool," he said.
Then he leaned forward.
"Why put me up when you haven't a card in your hand?"
I shrugged my shoulders. "Much cry, but little wool," said I. "Come to the point. Are you trying to do a deal?"
"Yes," said Rose Noble, "I am. Maybe it's a shade one-sided, but you gave it that name."
He jerked his torch at the ramp which led to the oubliette.
"I've yet to see these diggings, but I haven't played King of the Castle for a whole raft of years, and I guess it'll save us all time if you give me the Book of the Rules. In return, I offer you a painless captivity, a hell of a lot of hard work, and a free pass out 3 days after we touch. I laughed. It is one-sided, said I as cheerfully as I could. These sort of deals often are, was the grim reply. I could not think what to do. I was unarmed, for I had left my pistol for Rowley when he had taken my place. The other firearms hung upon a wall of the chamber, all of them loaded, but all of them out of my reach. Yet had they lain by my side, the fellow had me in check, and I knew that were I to move, he would shoot me down. For all that, my case was nothing to what it must be when Ellis and Job were come. Till then, at least, we were but man to man. But if Rose Noble was able to bring but one of them up, I was as good as lost. And so was our enterprise. That I must, therefore, take action before they could enter the chute was very evident, and I saw at once that when he went to admit them was the moment to make my attempt. His torch, of course, was his blessing and my unspeakable curse. But for this we should have been better matched, for though he had his pistol, I knew my way about and was indeed accustomed to moving in the gallery without any light. I therefore determined somewhat desperately that when he stooped for the flap, by hook or by crook, I must dash the torch from his mouth, and if I could not there and then follow up this assault, at least to jump to one side and so out of his ken. And here it came to me that, so far as his torch was concerned, my luck was indeed dead out. For if ever any one of us went up or down the chute without saving his torch from the water, whether because he forgot it or took the chance, so surely that torch was useless, and would give no glimmer of light until it had been looked to and its battery changed. So we stood, with the flap between us, I trying to watch Rose Noble behind the glare of the torch, he with his eyes upon mine, and both of us, I fancy, awaiting the throb of the bell. At length, "Well?" said Rose Noble. I moistened my lips. "There's nothing doing," said I. "Of course you can do me in, but it won't help you. For one thing, I'm not going to talk. For another, I've nothing to say, for, believe me or not, as you please, it's Mansell and Hanbury together that do the sums. You talk about guys that get stuck. Why, you've never been anything else. You've been stuck at the top of the Welsh Sea." "Here," said Rose Noble thickly. "When I want a lecture, I'll let you know. Meantime, I'll give you a hunch, and that is, get right with God." The man's hand was shaking, and I think this angered him, for he let out a frightful oath. "You say you're not going to talk," he continued presently. "Well, there's your right eye gone. I don't set up for a surgeon, but my hand don't always shake, and an inch of red-hot wire makes a nice clean job, and maybe when you're short of a light, you'll find your tongue. It's not an operation you'll find in the medical books, but by God, I've known it work." I suppose that the monster saw that his words had shocked me, as indeed, to be honest, they had, for while they were dreadful enough, the meaning with which he spoke them was unmistakable. At any rate, he laughed hideously, the fat laugh of a satyr that made my blood run cold. And as he laughed, the light of his torch went out. We were both of us taken by surprise. But for this particular accident, he, I imagine, was more unready than I, and though he fired, it was an instant too late, for I had taken my chance and leapt to the right. The crash of the explosion covered what noise I made, and before the racket was over, I was at the foot of the ramp, straining my ears. I heard him grope for my body and curse when he found me gone. The next moment he fired again, and the bullet parted my hair. He must have fired at a venture, but so good was the shot that it seemed as though he could see, and I turned and fled up the ramp like a startled hare. Now, before I had taken 10 steps, I saw the faint glow of the candles alight in the oubliette. These I had clean forgotten, but now in a flash I knew that I could not have made a more unfortunate move, for having escaped from one light, here I was making my way towards another. To make matters worse, as I perceived my mistake, I missed my footing and fell, making the deuce of a noise, and in an instant I heard Rose Noble behind. There was now nothing for it but to go on up the ramp, for this was far too narrow for me to let him go by. Indeed, I fully expected that he would fire again, but I suppose he was minded to husband his shots. I therefore went rapidly on, and had just decided to make a dash for the candles and put them out, if I could, before Rose Noble could reach the oubliette, when he let out a ha of triumph, which showed me that he had viewed the glimmer ahead. Now, the slightest reflection would have told me that moving from him to the glow, which was actually framed by the postern at the head of the ramp, I was offering such a target as no marksman could very well miss. And I think he must surely have been upon the edge of bringing me down when the bell from the chute was rung. Perhaps he held his hand to hear if it rang again, but if so, he lost his chance, for I suddenly perceived my folly and fell on my face. As I did so, the bell rang again, and then a third time. At once, Rose Noble began to descend the ramp. There was but one thing to do, and that was to follow him down. Once Ellis and Job were in, my race was as good as run, so down I went, moving beneath the shelter of the noise that he made, for till you had the way of it, the descent of the ramp was a difficult exercise, and racking my brain for some fair opportunity of giving battle. The rifles, and certainly two pistols, were hanging upon the west wall, that is to say, about 3 feet from the chute. We kept them there on purpose, that they might be always convenient to anyone leaving the chamber. But for me, they could not have hung in a more unfortunate place, and I could not think how to reach them without Rose Noble's knowledge that I was at hand. Suddenly my heart leapt, and I thought of the wood. At the eastern end of the gallery lay some timber, for we had not carried it all into the oubliette, and though a joist was plainly a clumsy weapon to ply within four walls, I was cheered by the thought that it was also a formidable arm and possessed the clear advantage of a considerable range. I therefore made haste to come down to the foot of the ramp, but as I gained the chamber, I heard Rose Noble setting aside the flap. How he had been so quick, I cannot tell, but I saw in an instant that if I was to dispute the entrance of Ellis and Job, I had not a second to lose. As I groped for the timber, I heard the ladder go down, and at that moment I touched a case of tinned food. This was open. Without waiting to think, I picked up a tin, what it contained I know not, but I think it was fruit, and hurled it with all my might at where Rose Noble must be. I know that it hit him, for he let out a cry of pain. But before he could fire, I had flung another tin. The case was full, and I had discharged 5 tins before I heard him coming with a volley of oaths. Instantly I whipped to the ramp, and as he went by, darted to the opposite wall. In a moment I had a pistol, and as he fired into the timber, I jerked up the ladder, and thrusting my arm into the chute itself, fired directly into the water below. That this would discourage Ellis, I felt very sure, and since he had no instructions except to ring the bell, he could hardly be blamed if, after such a reception, he beat a retreat. But there was still Rose Noble, and I knew very well that though I had prevented his fellows, I had done so at the price of provoking most deeply the wrath of this terrible man. And indeed, in a moment I heard a sound which told me that what had gone by was a skirmish, and that the battle à outrance was just about to begin. I heard the long, heavy breathing of a man who is out to kill. I had never heard it before, but it is a sound as fearful as it is expressive, and I must honestly confess that when I heard it, I was frightened to death. However, I tried to take heart by thinking that the odds were in my favour, for now we both were armed, and I was not only the more agile, but knew our surroundings as the palm of my hand. My first impulse was to fire in that direction from which the breathing came. But then I saw that the flash of my pistol would betray me, and that unless I hit him before I could move, he would return my shot. And there, of course, he had the advantage of me, for while I knew little of firearms, beyond that they must be handled with infinite care, Rose Noble gave the impression of being as ready with a pistol as are most men with a pen. Yet strange as it seems, I found his bullets far less dreadful than his presence itself, and the thought that he must be approaching pricked me to make a move. The first thing I did was to stumble upon the flap, and at once I heard him move forward towards the chute. Instinctively I shrank back to find myself in the corner of the north and west walls. How I had missed the chute I do not know, but there it was at my feet. I could feel its current of air. If I did not move now, I was lost, that is to say, unless I could kill my man, for I was literally cornered, and if Rose Noble came on, he would, any moment now, cut off my escape. I therefore stole to my left, and had come to the first embrasure, some 5 feet away, when something swept past my chin, and then, lightly touching the wall on my left, sailed horizontally back, missing me this time by a hair's breadth. Again I recoiled, thus making my second mistake, for an instant later I knew he had picked up a helve, and with this was sweeping the chamber to find me out. The moment the helve had sailed back, I should have advanced, but I had let the chance go. I was now fairly back in my corner, when again I heard the helve touch, this time the wall on my right. This, to my horror, for it showed that the cast which Rose Noble was making was almost done, and that in 4 or 5 seconds the fellow's terrible instinct would have its reward. I therefore dropped on one knee and set my left hand on the flags, the better to steady my aim. But I knew that the odds were against me, because the moment he touched me he would know where to fire, whilst I could not possibly tell to within some 2 or 3 feet. Rose Noble moved like a cat, giving no sound. Only the helve touched again, this time very close. I could hear the lap of the water and feel the air from the chute flirting my face. And then, all of a sudden, I saw a bare chance of escape. The flap, when sunk into place, lay flush with the pavement, and so supported by a ledge running round the chute, cut out of the stone. This ledge was 2 inches in width, wide enough to give handhold to a desperate man. Hardly waiting to pocket my pistol, I entered the chute, and a moment later I was altogether out of the gallery, yet able to re-enter at will, hanging by my hands from the ledge, staring up into the chamber to mark what I could. I heard Rose Noble above me, tapping all round with a helve. I could hear his breathing quite close, and something wet fell from him onto my upturned face. This was blood, so I knew I must have cut him with one of the tins. Suddenly I heard him stiffen and hold his breath. Then he turned round, and as in a theatre by some trick of production to pretend the coming of dawn, you may see the forms of men grow gradually out of the darkness, so I saw the monster begin to take shape. He was standing crouched, with his knees well bent and his left leg a little advanced. His great head was up, and his jaw jutted out like a peak. In his left hand he held the helve, and in his right was his pistol, pointed and ready to fire. His pistol arm was crooked and steady as any rock. He had but to drop his eyes for them to light upon me, but he did not, keeping them fixed instead upon what I judged must be the foot of the ramp. All this I saw at first dimly, but gradually more and more clearly to my great astonishment, for the effect was magical, and I could think of no earthly explanation. Then, in a flash, my brain cleared, and I knew it for the work of the searchlight which Mansell or Hanbury was carrying down the ramp. They must have entered the dungeon by way of the trap, and hearing no sound from the gallery, were hastening thither in a concern for me which could wait upon no risks. And here was I out of action, and there was Rose Noble, like a fowler, watching a bird come down into his snare. There was only one thing to be done. "Look out! It's Rose Noble!" I yelled, and let myself go. It was a rough passage and cost me a lot of skin, but of course I fell down like a stone and was, I suppose, underwater before Rose Noble had recovered from his surprise, for he never fired. A moment later I was swimming downstream. And that was the end of my adventure, for I had hardly landed upon the castle side when out of the forest came Rowley and asked me if I was unhurt. At first I thought I was dreaming, but he said that he had come straight from the staircase turret after letting the others into the oubliette. His orders were to put back the slabs, destroy every trace of their removal, and then lie close in the woods till break of day. He was then to cross the river, and if he saw a towel in a window, to come to the chute. But I would not wait so long, because I feared that, finding me gone when he had dispatched Rose Noble, Mansell would go out in my quest, So since the boat was at hand, we at once sculled back to the chute, and there, sure enough, met Mansell about to go out after Rowley and then after me.
"Are you hurt?" said he at once.
"Not a scratch," said I. "Where's Rose Noble?"
"Upstream, I think," said Mansell, climbing into the boat.
Then he bade me go up to the gallery and expect him and Rowley again in 10 minutes' time. When I asked him where he was going, he said, "To bestow the boat." When I was up in the chamber, I was not surprised that he had asked me if I was hurt, for though there was little disorder, blood was all over the place. We afterwards learned that this came from Rose Noble's head, which I had cut open, most likely with the first tin I threw. And this shows how tough the man was, for all his grossness, for the tin must have weighed 3 pounds, and I flung it with all my might. Hanbury had little to tell, beyond that, as Mansell surmised, he had lost his way in the dark, and, horrified at hearing my shots, had made at once for the junction to see what was there towards. There he had found Ellis and Job and the tanner, and another he did not know. Ellis was raving about the escape of the rolls and vowing most shocking vengeance against whosoever it was that had cut the ropes, and the four then appeared to be watching the road and the river in observance of some design he could not comprehend. He had seen the 2 flashes from the woods, as also had they, and it was Job who had at once repeated the signal. Not long after that, the windows of the gallery had suddenly been illumined, to Hanbury's horror and the great surprise of the thieves, who seemed too much dumbfounded to utter a word, though the tanner and his fellow let out at once a flood of excited talk. But then Hanbury had left them, to hasten in fear and trembling down to the water's edge, where he had run into Mansell himself, hotfoot for the boat. And there, when Mansell returned, he took up the tale. Rose Noble was in a boat, moored in midstream. I believe he was there all the time. In his eyes, the rolls was a plum, of which he would have been very glad, but our pithead was the very pie itself. So Ellis was given the job of taking the rolls, but Rose Noble took on the business of locating and seizing the pithead. It was Punter, I imagine, that heard us as we were sculling downstream and gave the signal which Hanbury saw Job repeat. Rose Noble must have been beside us, whilst you, Chandos, went up and Rowley came down. But being as shrewd as they make 'em, he held his hand. So much for speculation. I've had some shocks in my life, but the sight of those windows lighted hit me between the eyes. We made enough noise embarking to be heard for a furlong or more, but Ellis and Co., I suppose, had no ears to hear. There was no room for Rowley, but he laid hold of the painter and swam behind. We missed Friend Bunch by inches. I suppose he had lost his direction, for he was sculling downstream. So we came to the chute. When I saw this was shut, I decided to go for the trap as fast as we could. We dropped downstream and landed below the road of approach. I'm afraid we must have broken all Punter's marks, but that couldn't be helped. Whilst I was forcing the door of the kitchen hall, George and Rowley ran to the well for rope. They were back with a coil and a blanket before Bell and I had withdrawn the second slab. When we were down, we could hear no sound at all. The light we had seen was gone, and I don't mind admitting that I was deeply concerned. Now, a torch always makes you a target, yet I felt I must have light, so I sent Bell off for the searchlight without more ado. What then happened, you know. But for your warning, Chandos, Rose Noble must have shot me dead. As it was, the tables were turned. Hanbury sat down in the ramp with the searchlight between his knees, and I took my stand behind him, ready to fire. I fancy Rose Noble knew that the game was up. To bring us within his range, he was bound to enter the beam, and the moment he entered the beam, he would be certainly blinded and almost certainly shot. By way of rubbing this in, I audibly requested Hanbury to advance a couple of feet. A moment later, I heard him go down the chute. Whilst we were eating some supper, I told my tale over again. But when Hanbury and I would have discussed the future, Mansell checked us with a yawn. And then he laughed. "Sufficient unto this day is the evil thereof. Rose Noble has gone far enough towards murdering sleep. Don't let us finish it off." And then he told Bell to lay his bed, when he made it, across the flap of the chute. "I don't see how they can lift it," he added slowly,
but tonight has shown me that I don't know a risk when I see one, so from now on I'm going to turn every stone. And then and there, I happened to look at my watch. At first, I made sure it had stopped, but when I had checked it with Hanbury's, I found it was telling the time. This was 5 minutes to 12. And since we had been at supper for half an hour, my passage with Rose Noble cannot have taken up more than 10 or 12 minutes of time. And that, but for its proof, I never would have believed. Soon the lights were put out, and we lay down to take our rest. But for an hour or more I could not slumber for thinking of those 10 or 12 minutes and how close to death I had come. And here let me say I was sorry for Rose Noble, for unconscionable villain though he was, he deserved to have won that trick. To enter the gallery as he did was a great accomplishment, and but for the failure of his torch, he must, I think, have brought us all to our knees. Yet all he got for his valour was a broken head.
Chapter 8. The Race for the Chamber. The next morning, we held a short council. The system of reliefs which had served us so long and so well was now a thing of the past, and we were all agreed that once we had closed our bases, except to communicate with Carson or to go out as a spy, no one must leave the dungeon until the treasure was won. That the stranger whom Hanbury had seen was the tanner's brother, we had no doubt, and to judge from the fellow's demeanour, so far as we were concerned, the two were at one with the thieves. If this were so, since they were the innkeeper's allies, our enemies now numbered 8 instead of 5. Yet neither of these conclusions troubled us near so much as the thought that Rose Noble must know that there was a second entrance into the oubliette. This was a serious matter, for now that he knew, he would not rest till he had found it, and as if that were not enough, we had left him a definite clue. Rowley had covered our tracks as best he could, but he could not repair the door which Mansell had forced. Its broken condition the thieves were bound to remark, and the instant they saw it, they would know that the entrance they sought led out of the castle itself. "And so," said Mansell, "it's only a matter of time. It may take them a day or an hour, but in the end they'll find it, and then the balloon will go up. Now, if we guarded the trap, though they found it, to force an entry that way might be very hard, for 3 men armed in the darkness could hold it against an army similarly equipped. But what a man has done once, he will do again, and we had little doubt that if we opposed their entry, they would at once resort to the use of that terrible weapon which they had already employed, that is to say, bombs. And stand up to these we could not, if for no other reason, because against such an attack, no man born of woman could hope to hold such a place. We could bar the postern of knights, we could set an electric alarm above the stile, we could keep watch, but more we could not do, and must try the fortune of war when the moment came. But Mansell decided that in future we must always go armed, even though we were working at the nose of the shaft. It was then arranged that the next morning I should go to the culvert, and taking the rolls from Carson, send him back to the dungeon and myself drive to St. Martin for the last time. "You see," said Mansell, "at the moment we're not up against time, but I shouldn't be surprised if we were before the curtain comes down. Give me 5 minutes' start, and I'll be at Calais 5 hours before Rose Noble, but not if I've got to trip around paying my bills. So we'll do 3 more reliefs. When you've bade farewell to St. Martin, Hanbury can visit Villach, and then I can go to Salzburg and make all smooth and clear for us to withdraw. I think we should each go alone, because 4's none too many to hold the fort. And I think we'll have Tester here. He'll rather like this place, and he'll be devilish useful watching that trap." With that, we talked no more, but went to work. Mansell and Hanbury to setting the electric alarm, and Rowley and Bell and I to driving the shaft. 13 days had gone by since we had altered our course, and so well had we wrought in this time that but 23 yards lay between us and what we had come to call live ground. We gave it that name because, though we knew it was surrounding the chamber as a garden, a house, we were far less certain where within it the chamber lay. We hoped and believed that by holding straight on through this region, we should strike some part of the chamber before we had gone 5 yards. We were equally sure that if we had not found it in 9, this would be because we had passed it, and in such an event we proposed to go no further but to drive a new shaft at right angles through the middle of the live ground. We had made up our minds that this region was not more than 9 yards square, and we steadfastly refused to consider that somewhere within its area the chamber did not lie. Whether the progress we made was actually swift or slow, I cannot fairly pronounce, for how 6 sextons would have fared had they been set such a task, I cannot say. But what we lacked in experience, I think we made up in zeal. And after all, digging is a simple downright business which one man, if he will, can soon do as well as another. Be that as it may, I do not think any men could have laboured more heartily than we did since our brush with the tanner upon the 9th night of June. But now, since our life was to be less easy, we determined to cut our confinement as short as ever we could, and to that end to redouble our efforts to reach our goal. We had not much hope of so doing before the thieves discovered the trap, but there was a chance that we might, and faint though it was, this certainly spurred us on, for although we were ready enough to show our teeth, once such a battle was joined, no one could possibly tell what the outcome would be. And there, of course, the thieves had a valuable advantage, for if one of them was wounded, the others would let him lie or die for want of attention rather than care for him to the cost of their enterprise. But if one of us was hurt and needed a doctor's aid, everything else, of course, would go by the board. In this sense, the dice were loaded, and though hitherto we had been most fortunate, this spectre always haunted each passage of arms that we had. Full of these thoughts, we worked as hard as we could, and by the end of that day had actually advanced 5 yards, so that but 18 remained between us and the live ground. At 1 o'clock the next morning, I left for the culvert, charged by Mansell to swim down the middle of the river and not to attempt to land for 1/4 mile. I was then to strike across country and by no means to use the road until I had left the junction 2 miles behind. Directly I had found Carson, I was to send him back, for else it would be broad daylight before he could reach the chute. "Indeed," said Mansell, "I'm banking on your meeting by 2:30, for Carson is sure to be early, and so I think are you, for the culvert is less than 4 miles as the crow flies. Tell him on no account to let Tester off the lead and to hold the end in his mouth as he swims to the chute." I was at the culvert at 2:30 and had just found the note which Carson had lodged in the brickwork under the arch when I heard a step above me, and there he was. 2 minutes later he and Tester were gone, and I was turning the rolls. There was little to do at St. Martin except to collect my belongings and pay my bill, but I had to explain how it was that I came a day late and alone and without the basket which my hostess had so often put up. I might have found this hard, but between their relief to see me and their distress to learn that I should return no more, the good people seemed to have no room left for surprise. Indeed, I might have been a fugitive monarch resting at the house of a loyal subject before resuming his flight, for they could not do enough to show their esteem and goodwill. And when at last I left them, I had to give them my word that I would one day come back, and even so, enough honest tears were shed to make me feel ashamed that I had imposed so much on their simplicity. Hanbury met me at the culvert, but had nothing at all to report, save that another 5 yards had been added to the length of the shaft, and by the time he was back on the following day, we were within 8 yards of the live ground. We were all glad of Tester, and Tester was glad of us. He soon understood that when there was no one to spare, he was expected to guard the oubliette, and I think he enjoyed wandering about in the darkness, for now we burned no lights except in the gallery and at the nose of the shaft, and conducting an endless scrutiny of the great banks of earth. The chute seemed to fascinate him, and he always contrived to be present when its flap was withdrawn. I fancy he thought that it must have been made by some beast, and was continually hoping that its creator would emerge. When Carson took his leave, I could not help wondering when we should see him again, for with Mansell's return, the last of our reliefs would be over, and if all went well, The next time we crossed the river would be the last. He was very loath to leave us, and constantly lamented that he had not killed Rose Noble on the night when we visited the well. 1 minute more, he would say, and I should have had him cold. And that would have saved us a peck of trouble, sir, for if ever I saw one, there goes a dangerous man. Be sure I agreed with him. And yet I must honestly confess that if we had suddenly learned that the thieves had withdrawn, the game would have lost a curiously attractive savour, which even the lifting of the treasure would not have wholly restored. For danger, once you have tasted it, is a superlative spice. If Carson was loath to go, we were sorry enough to lose him, for he was a fine workman and a first-class shot. What was more, he had the brain of a fighter, and though there might be no one to lead him, could be trusted to think for himself and hold his own. However, neither Rowley nor Bell could manage a car as could he. Besides which, it was good to know that our line of retreat was held by such capable hands. His instructions were clear. So soon as he reached Salzburg, he was to lay up the rolls and, taking the second car, drive her to Villach. There he was to bestow her at the inn which Hanbury had used, and then to return by train in search of the rolls. After that, he was to go no more to Salzburg, but to take up his quarters at Villach, holding both cars in condition to leave at an instant's notice by day or night. Each night, at 11 o'clock, he was to be at the culvert, and having concealed the rolls, to wait there till 12. He was then to walk to a point a mile and a half away, where 7 trees grew together on the top of a hill. From here could be seen the castle and a slice of the river below. If he saw nothing unusual, he was to go his way. If he saw one window lighted, he was to return to the culvert and wait till we came. If he saw 2 illumined, he was to leave the rolls and come to the chute. But if all 3 were aglow, he was to get the rolls and drive down past the junction and onto the Lerai road. We had little to report to Mansell beyond that our progress had been slow, for since he had left, we had only advanced 3 yards, because we had encountered a boulder as big as a sheep, the dislodgement and disposal of which had taken the best part of 5 hours. But if, instead of progressing, we had actually retired, I do not think Mansell would have cared, because he was so much relieved to find that the secret of the trap was still inviolate, and that we had not, in his absence, been called upon to fight for our lives. That day we made a great effort, and by 8 o'clock that evening we had reached the coveted region and had broken the live ground. Our excitement now began to run high, and I was for bolting my supper in order to get back to work, but Mansell said he should like to visit the coombe and me to go with him. It may seem idle, he said, but those who don't look don't see. To visit the well or the castle would take more time than I think we can fairly spare, but to go to the coombe and back will take us less than an hour. I hope and believe it will be our last reconnaissance, but I think we ought to make it before we take off our coats for the final push. And so we went out together when it was dark. Hanbury told me later that when we returned, Mansell was rather pale, but I looked an older man. I have no doubt I did. For although we had seen no one and heard no sound, what we had found was enough to age any man who thinks the fruits of his labour worth taking up. At the foot of the gutter, we had found a miniature lake. Now, whilst we were drawing water, we had never gone down to see the pool we had made, and though we all remembered the sodden condition of the ground on the day I was taken by Ellis, that was nothing to go by, for then no water had been drawn for 18 or 20 hours. We had, therefore, the bare fact before us that the enemy was making for the first time a truly formidable effort to empty the well, a feat which we had accomplished in less than 3 days. How long they had been at work, how much water they had drawn, how the results of their labour were comparing with those of ours, we could not so much as guess. But what 6 men had done, 8 men could do, and this indisputable verity, sternly illustrated by the lake at the foot of the coombe, bade fair to sap the resolution from which our endeavours sprang. I can only speak for myself, but I know that when I was back in the gallery, I felt tired and was glad to sit down, and that when Bell brought me dry shoes, the business of changing seemed a burden, and I told him to put them down and let me be. Then I heard Mansell laugh. "Rose Noble leads," he said lightly. "And yet I'll back the old firm. There's the strait to be covered yet, and I fancy they're full of running. Besides, I don't know how you fellows feel, but I haven't shoveled dirt for 6 weeks for the pleasure of watching Rose Noble pick my peach. Then again, the game's the thing. And now let's see where we stand. As yet, they've not got to the shaft. That is clear, for that water was drawn today, but the gutter was dry, which means they've stopped work for the night. If it was over and they'd found, there wouldn't be so much water at the foot of the coombe, for once they've uncovered the shaft, they've only to bail to keep the water down, and 5 hours bailing wouldn't make all that mess. Again, I know they're eight, but only four will draw water as fast as we, and one of those, Rose Noble, has something better to do, for you can't command such a rabble and bear a hand as well. Besides, I'll stake my oath that water to draw or no, Rose Noble's still trying to find the way to the oubliette, and I think it more than likely that they're keeping an eye on the chute. And last of all, they none of them know of the bars. And that's a fruit of the thought, for I'll lay my soul to a cesspool that apart from anything else, they're short of a file. With that, he ordered Rowley to open a case of champagne. For though, said he, I meant us to drink it when the treasure had been won, now that I come to think, we might not have time, and it seems a pity to leave it for Ellis and Rose. I can relate his words, but I cannot describe the way in which he spoke them, or the quiet, confident manner with which he seemed to be putting misfortune to shame. Enough that he lifted us up and carried us all away. And since neither Hanbury nor I would wait for the wine, Mansell himself brought a bottle to the nose of the shaft and made us drink. We worked straight through the night, and it was 8 the next morning before Mansell called a halt. By then we had tunnelled 4 yards into the live ground. This had meant working at a tremendous pace, for we faithfully maintained its dimensions and propped the shaft as we went. The heat was awful, and the want of air most vile, but we had grown used to these conditions, from which we had begun to suffer as soon as we turned the shaft. Still, we came down into the galleries, swaying like drunken men, and Hanbury and Bell fell asleep over their food. Then Mansell told Rowley and me to take our rest, and said that he should take Tester and sleep in the oubliette. I believe he said something else, for I remember laughing, but before my laughter was over, I was asleep. Now how long Mansell slept, I do not know, but he woke us at noon to say that he had sunk a crowbar at the nose of the shaft and had encountered water 4 feet below its floor. Except that he had found the chamber, he could not have brought us more encouraging news, for it showed that we had at least no vertical error to fear, and that roughly our floor was level with that of the chamber itself. In a moment, therefore, we were wide awake and afoot and all agog to return to the nose of the shaft. But of this, Mansell would not hear until we had all of us bathed and broken our fast. "Method in all things," he said. "Disorder never won yet and never will. We went off the deep end last night, but we're not going to do it again. From now on, we'll labour by shifts. They'll always be 4 at work and 1 at rest. I don't know how much we can stand, but it won't be for long, and 4 hours on to 1 off seems the most convenient rule." And whilst we were eating, he outlined what must be done to cope with a sudden attack. "The one who is off duty must sleep in the oubliette. Tester will wake him all right in the event of attack. The moment he's waked, he will withdraw to the ramp, of course taking Tester with him, and close the postern gate. And he will hold the ramp while the others will hold the shaft. In this way we shall have them between 2 fires, and if we don't loose off too soon, it ought to be a walkover." Then he told us to mind how we went at the head of the ramp, as well as at the mouth of the shaft, because he had built 2 breastworks out of some sacks of earth. "Why, you can't have rested at all," cried Hanbury. "I had 2 full hours, said Mansell, "and now I'm off to have 1 more. Chandos, what time do you make it?" I told him 12:20. "I shall be your relief," said he. "I count upon you to wake me at 1:30. I suppose I hesitated, for he continued at once, "Unless you give me your word, I shall not sleep." "I promise," said I. "Very good," said Mansell. "But if before then you strike oil, well, I don't mind being called early to hear the news." 5 minutes later, we were at the nose of the shaft. We had still 5 yards to go before we should come to the end of the belt of live ground, but though we went steadily forward, we now took to searching right and left by dint of driving a crowbar as though it were a great nail into the wall. Again and again by this means we thought we had found the chamber, but when we had laid bare the obstruction, Each time it proved to be some boulder or two or three smaller stones. In this way, the tunnel began to lose its symmetry, and though this could not be helped, the propping of the roof with timber became a less downright business and wasted a lot of time. We worked frantically, speaking very little, but doing the best we could to maintain the system of labor which should turn to the best account such joint strength as we had. The hewer stood on a sheet onto which his winnings must fall. As soon as these began to encumber him, he would stand back and away. At once his assistant would draw back the sheet from the face and lay in its place another to catch the next fall of earth. The assistant then disposed of the soil he had drawn away, and by the time he was back, the second sheet would be full. The carpenter followed the hewer as close as he could, pitching his uprights and crossbars and wedging them into place, and the fourth was man-of-all-work, now shoveling loose earth that had fallen clear of the sheet or had not fallen, now helping the carpenter, and now bringing up fresh wood. An hour before his relief, each man had a pint of champagne, and when he was waked, was given a quarter of an hour in which to bathe and eat. Mansell fed Tester himself twice in the day, and that was all the attention the poor dog had. Yet he was as good as gold, never obtruding himself as so many dogs would have done, but seeming to know that we were fighting with time and faithfully keeping to his post in the oubliette. By 11 o'clock that night, we had advanced 5 yards and were clear of the live ground. It was impossible not to be disappointed, and very hard not to be dismayed. And when I had called for a crowbar, and with 3 mighty blows slammed this up to its head into the nose of the shaft and touched not so much as a pebble, I think we all avoided each other's eyes. But Hanbury, for Mansell was resting, wasted no time. By his direction, we immediately withdrew 5 yards and began to drive a new tunnel out of the left-hand wall. For no reason that I can offer, the half-hour that followed seems for me to stand out of that period of toil and trouble. And I remember most vividly the sob of the hewer each time that he launched his pickaxe, and the smell of sweat, and the blinding glare of the searchlight, and even a mark on a timber retaining the left-hand wall. To our right, the 5 yards we had won to no purpose continually mocked us, like the psalmist's bulls of Bashan, gaping upon us with its mouth. To our left, our long, clean-cut gallery seemed to be leading fantastically into another world. I can see Hanbury poising the compass and hear him curse as his sweat fell onto its dial, and when Bell, who was hewing, missed his stroke, I remember snatching the pickaxe and missing mine. So the work went on, and the niche in the left-hand wall had grown to an entrance when Hanbury looked at his wristwatch and cried that my time was up. I stumbled back to wake Mansell and fell asleep in his stead, for the champagne had done its business and my knees were beginning to sag. Almost at once, Hanbury woke me, and I started up with a cry. "Have you found?" "Found be damned," says George. "You've had 5 minutes over your time." So it was with us all. And we battled rather than labored, fighting with nature like madmen in our effort to find the chamber before she could wear us down. For the pace was too hot to last, we all knew that, and unless we could win very soon, we were playing a losing game. Yet we went steadily on, like men in a dream, losing all count of time and confusing night with day. Indeed, the demands of the battle so wholly possessed our senses that, used in some other direction, these were beginning to fail. We shouted one to another when a whisper could have been heard. The hand that could still ply a hammer could not be trusted to raise a glass to the lips, and if ever I glanced at my wristwatch, this seemed a great way off. At 9:15 the next morning, our new shaft was 8 yards deep. And this alone shows that we were beside ourselves, for though we had cut down the width, relying upon the crowbar to make this good, such progress was superhuman. Yet to advance this shaft further seemed little worth, and we started another tunnel out of its right-hand wall. This was by Hanbury's direction, for Mansell was resting, and we others knew no more where to turn than the man in the moon. "Are you certain," said I, "that we're not too far to the left?" "Certain," said Hanbury. "Mansell will bear me out. The shaft from the well to the chamber is not so steep as we thought, so we've aimed too much to the right. You mark my words, if you don't strike the chamber this time, we shall hit the shaft." Such confidence did us good. But when I roused Mansell, I saw him tighten his lips, and I knew that he had been hoping to be sent for before his time. I now know that I must have slept for nearly my hour when I dreamed I was listening to Mansell broadcasting news and that a storm somewhere was blotting out what he had said. I must have dreamed for some moments, for I was heavy with sleep, but at last awoke to find Tester barking like fury 3 feet away. In an instant, I had caught him up and had blundered through the postern to fall headlong over the breastwork with the dog in my arms. However, I was up in a moment and made haste to close the gate, but I dared not fasten it closely for fear of a bomb. I had much ado to quiet Tester, who was seething with wrath, but when I had done so and could listen, I heard no sound. So we lay still for 5 minutes. Then I heard Mansell's voice. "Are you at your post, Chandos?"
"I am," said I.
"What happened?"
"I've no idea," said I. "I woke up to find Tester barking, and that's as much as I know."
"Stay where you are," said he. Then he unmasked the searchlight and turned the beam onto the trap. Presently he raked the dungeon, letting the beam discover the timber and piles of earth. At length, "Let Tester go," he said, "and you come in." The dog ran to him at once and jumped up to lick his face. Then he turned away and began to growl and bristle with his eyes on the trap. "Not much doubt about that," said Mansell, stooping to make much of the dog. "Our friends have found the front door. I suppose they're not quite ready, and that's why they've shut it again. Well, we're quite ready when they are, and till then, we may as well work." Then he sent me to bathe and eat, and when I came back, Hanbury was asleep in the dungeon with Tester in the crook of his arm. We gave him no more time to the riddle, for in truth we had none to give. The business smacked of a nightmare, yet our present life was a dream, and so if we thought, we did not speak of it, but tacitly took it for granted that Mansell's interpretation was good. At 6 o'clock that evening, we started another shaft. The last we had driven 5 yards, and had sunk a 3 feet crowbar into its nose, and found nothing. And so, at 6 o'clock, we started another shaft. This was driven from the nose of our second, so that our original tunnel would soon be a left-handed fork with 3 5-yard prongs. And here I am bound to record that we were beginning to fail. I will swear that the spirit was willing, but the flesh was beginning to flag. It was nearly 45 hours since Mansell and I had returned from our reconnaissance, and though in that time we had each had 10 hours sleep, the reconnaissance had come at the end of a full day's toil. We had therefore been jaded when we began to spurt, and our spurt was losing its sting because it did not end. We were beginning to fail. I knew that my strength was failing and tried to conceal the fact. I fancy the others did the same, for the collapse of one must mean the end of our effort. The camel's back would have broken. Not even Mansell could have carried another straw. When I roused him at 7:30, he held up 2 canvas kit bags for me to see. "The burglar's delight," said he, with half a laugh. I tried to laugh back, and lay down, but not to sleep. And there was the surest sign that the end was at hand, for it showed that the flesh was rebelling against its chastisement. When Mansell returned from the gallery, he stopped to peer at me. I pretended slumber, but his action showed me that he, too, had not slept. I think the hour that followed was the worst I have ever spent. I was so sick and weary that I would have sold a kingdom for unconsciousness, but this was steadfastly withheld, and though at times I fell into a kind of doze, this state was more dreadful than my first, for then my brain was unruly and flitted and gambolled as a gnat on a summer's eve. I was indeed thankful when Hanbury limped into the dungeon and I could go back in his place. The gallery we were now driving was completing the uppermost prong of the letter E, the upright of which was formed by our second shaft and the base or bottom prong by the last 5 yards of our first. But because of all our sounding, the works had a shapeless look and seemed to reflect the frenzy with which they had been done. The roof and walls were eccentric, and the timbers were all awry. Indeed, the carpenter's task was now fit work for a wizard, and faithfully to prop and retain such irregular excavation was almost impossible. At 10:30 that night, our new shaft was 2 yards deep. Mansell, Hanbury, and I were working alone, for Bell had just left to rouse Rowley and take his place. And all was quiet, for Mansell had stopped for a moment to drink his wine, Hanbury was pencilling a timber, which he was going to saw, and I, who was hewing, was extracting a morsel of dirt which had made its way into my eye. At first I thought Hanbury's pencil was making a scraping noise. Then I saw he had stopped and was listening, and that Mansell was doing the same. For a moment, no one of us moved. Then Hanbury stepped to my side and set his ear to a hole which the crowbar had made a foot back in the left-hand wall. "That's right," said he after a moment. "It's coming from here." Then he stood away, and I made play with a pickaxe about the hole. I had soon made a hollow in which by sinking the crowbar we should gain another foot. But before we did this, Mansell tore off his zephyr and folded it into a pad which should muffle the sound of the blows. Gently, I drove the bar home and could almost have pressed it for the last foot of its way, and I drew it out with my hands without any effort at all. The noise was distinct now, a thin, regular murmur, as if somebody was whetting a chisel upon a hone. What it was, I could not imagine, and was just beginning to think that our calculations had led us to the top of the well, when Mansell let out a sob and caught us each by an arm. "My God, I've got it," he cried. "That's the chamber ahead, and they're filing the bars." There is, I believe, a height at which a man's heart will break. And so I suppose there is a pitch of excitement at which a man's brain will balk. And I think we had come to this, for Mansell was trembling as a man smitten with an ague. If I had tried to speak, I should have broken down. And while we were standing thus silent, Hanbury's knees sagged, and he fell down in a swoon. The faint was nothing, and before I had brought the bucket, which was standing 10 paces away, George was again on his feet, but we made him dip his head in the water, and then Mansell and I did the same. Then we fell to, like madmen, to deepen the breach I had made. We worked in what silence we could and let the carpentry go. Each of us hewed for 2 minutes, while the others withdrew his winnings and strewed them about the shafts. Now and again we had to employ the shovel, but mostly we used our hands, so as to make less noise. All the time, the noise of the filing went steadily on, only ceasing from time to time to instantly recommence. Each time that it stopped, our hearts went into our mouths, for close as we were, if once the bars were severed, we might have been 5 miles off for all the good we could do. When Rowley came back, we told him and sent him back to tell Bell. "And say," said Mansell, "that I may not arrive when I should, but that whatever happens, he must remain where he is, for now the case is altered, and he and Tester are holding our line of retreat." Rowley was back in 2 minutes and wild to take his turn, and once he had got it, he would not surrender the pickaxe, and I had fairly to wrest it out of his hands. Now, what the time was when it happened, I do not know, for I cannot tell to an hour how long we took to cut through that last 3 feet, but I know that I launched the pickaxe, and its head went out of my sight, and that there I was, looking through a hole into an empty space, beyond which, when they gave me the light, I could see a stone wall. It was the chamber indeed. At once, I saw that the well-digger's excavation had been bigger than the chamber itself, and that they had not lined the cavity which they had dug, but had built the chamber within it, like a box within a box. There was now no mistaking the whine of iron biting iron, and it sounded to our frantic ears as though whosoever was filing was nearing the end of his task. We therefore fell to, like fury, and soon had a ragged window, I suppose some 3 feet square, opening into the cavern in which the chamber stood. A moment's inspection now showed that the chamber was round, like the well, and was plainly constructed of stones which had been cut by the masons to build the walls of the well. To break out of the chamber, therefore, would have been 10 times as simple as to break in, for the stones were undoubtedly wedge-shaped, and that being so, if they were truly laid, a battering ram itself would not avail us. The joints, moreover, were as fine as those of the walls of the well, and to cut out one stone with a chisel would have taken an hour or more. "What of the roof?" whispered Mansell.
At once, I stretched up an arm to find the roof just out of sight. But 2 minutes' work with the pickaxe had laid the edge of it bare. Now, how the roof was constructed, I do not know. But between the slab we could see and the stones upon which it was resting, there was a layer of mortar as thick as a Camembert cheese. And this was so loose that I picked out a piece with my thumb. Here, then, was the way to break in. For we had but to drive a chisel, and when it was fairly in, to lever against the slab to prise a stone out of the wall. And once the stone was out, we could make our breach. And when we do, breathed Mansell, look out for squalls. You can bet your life they're not going to give us this trick. We had to make for the lever, so once more I handled the pickaxe, whilst the others marshalled the tools for the final assault. All this time, the filing continued, and to judge from the ring of the metal, some bar was nearly in two. Indeed, as I threw down the pickaxe, again the noise stopped, and we heard some blows administered as though the workman believed he could burst asunder the filament that remained. We waited to hear no more. I fitted the edge of the chisel into the chink, and whilst I held it, Mansell hammered it home. The stone below must have been loose, for the moment we levered, it yielded, and a second later I pulled it out with my hands. The two below came away, and as Hanbury gave me the searchlight, I heard a strangled cry. On the tiny floor was a bag, thick covered with dust, of the shape of a sack of corn. Its mouth was shut, but one of its sides was gaping and spilling the stuff it held. By its side was another, but this was all gone to ruin, and its contents lay in a heap. The dust lay so deep over all that it might have been trash, but I saw the shape of a crucifix standing up out of the ruck. Immediately opposite was the entrance, barred by the four iron bars. Behind these, I saw two faces, unshaven, like those of beasts. The one I had never seen, but the other was that of Ellis. And that, I believe, I shall see so long as I live, for if ever the devil possessed the soul of a man, he possessed it then. The other seemed blinded by the searchlight, but Ellis glared full at the lamp, as though it were no more than a taper, with his face working with passion and his eyes staring out of his head. Suddenly he laid hold of the bars and wrenched them this way and that, screaming like some animal with rage. And when they would not yield to his frenzy, he clapped his face up against them and spat like any demoniac, lending the whole force of his body to the disgusting act. Then he started as one who recovers his presence of mind, and I saw a hand fly to his hip. At that moment, Mansell fired, and the fellow fell suddenly forward against the bars. As he did so, the other man turned, and Mansell fired again. But when the noise had subsided, we could hear him descending the shaft. Then Ellis's body slipped sideways till the head was against the wall, which held it up at an angle which was different to that of the trunk. God forgive me, said Mansell, but I'd do it again. With that, I climbed into the chamber, and Mansell followed me in. With the hammer and crowbar, we soon had three more stones out, and Hanbury made his way in. Then Mansell told Rowley to give him the canvas bags. And quick's the motto, said he. I missed the tanner, and now he'll give the alarm. But once we're beyond the postern, they can have the oubliette. Rowley had brought the bags, and was standing without the chamber, looking in, with his hands on the wall, when I heard a rustle behind him, and saw him drop suddenly forward across the breach we had made. A mass of soil had broken away from the window and had fallen on the back of his legs. He was not hurt, but was pinned, and whilst I supported his body, Mansell and Hanbury climbed back into the tunnel and shifted the fallen earth. They worked feverishly, but 2 or 3 minutes went by before he was free, and I was able to help him into the chamber. And that, breathed Mansell, brushing the dirt from his hands, is about as clear a time signal as ever there was. I held one canvas bag open and Rowley the other, while Mansell and Hanbury shoveled the stuff within. There was gold and stones and jewels and all manner of lovely things, but I think we were thinking of safety and the way to the oubliette. Then Mansell lifted his head and touched Hanbury on the arm. For a moment, we knelt there, listening. Then something faint but clear came Tester's vigorous bark. And that was the only time we heard him give tongue that night. For the next instant came a shuffling and then a rumbling sound. And when we had brought the searchlight up to the breach in the wall, had we not known its angle, we could not have told where the shaft we had driven had been. "Where's the pickaxe?" said Mansell quietly. I told him it had lain in the shaft. Then came another rumble, and the searchlight went out. Chapter 9. Out of the Eater. Had our doom been set forth upon paper and submitted to Rose Noble himself for his approval, I cannot believe that he would have altered one particular. We were entombed alive. This by our own act, with the treasure under our hand, in the knowledge of an attack upon one man and a dog who would count in vain upon our succor. Had we had the tools, we had no longer the strength to hew our way back. Indeed, to judge from the sound, it seemed likely that 10 or more yards of our tunnel had fallen in. Yet could we have performed this unthinkable task, it would only have been to fall into the enemy's hands. And the other way out was barred. And beyond the bars was the shaft, the mouth of which would be sealed in less than an hour. And beyond the shaft was the well, some 90 feet deep. Mansell was speaking. The first thing to do is to keep calm. The second is to break these bars. And now, please, don't move for a moment, or we shall collide. We heard him make his way to the entrance. When he was there, he spoke again. Chandos, come here and lift Ellis. If I can find it, we may as well have his torch. At once, I moved to the entrance, and thrusting my hands between the bars, seized the corpse under its arm and endeavored to lift it up. But it was too heavy for me, so Mansell and Hanbury raised me whilst I held it against the bars. The torch was a light in a pocket into which the dead man must have thrust it so soon as he heard our chisel enter the wall, and when Mansell had taken it out and had felt in the other pockets, he told me to throw back the body away from the bars. This I was thankful to do. The entrance was a frame of hewn stone, 8 inches thick. In this, the bars were set upright, 4 inches apart, and close to its foot, one was filed almost through. We cut this in two with a chisel without delay, but if we then expected that our release was at hand, we were grievously disappointed. God knows what smith it was that wrought that bar, but he was a craftsman that knew his mystery, and I do not believe that such art is practiced today. Severed though it was, we could neither break nor bend it, and when we attempted to lever it up with the crowbar, we bent this into a loop. There lay the file within reach, but we could not bear the thought of a labor so lengthy and cudgelled our weary brains to find out some other way.
Now, the bars were all sunk, top and bottom, into holes cut in the stone. And though our treatment had not displaced it, the upper portion of the bar we had cut could now be turned round in its socket and even moved up and down, and but for the lower portion which opposed it, it would have come down and away. Perceiving this, we determined to loosen the lower piece in the hope that we could then raise this up until it was clear of its bed and thus remove the whole bar by simply reversing the procedure by which it was undoubtedly set up. It did not take long to loosen the lower portion, but either because the stonework itself had settled or because when the bars were planted some trick of masonry was used, we could not make enough play to free this piece from its bed. The knowledge that the water below was rising fast and that the mouth of the shaft would soon be sealed, made it hard to give our minds to the problem as freely as we would have wished, and easy to return to methods which we had already discarded as forlorn. And this, I suppose, was the beginning of panic. Be that as it may, I remember Mansell sitting down with his head in his hands, whilst I leaned against the wall, holding the torch and watching Rowley filing like a madman, and Hanbury, with a hammer and chisel, trying to cut a channel out of the stone. Suddenly, "Look here," said Mansell, rising. "Why don't we try the wall? It let us in, and why shouldn't it let us out? And once we're out, we can break our way into the shaft." We should, of course, have attempted this long before, but I suppose it was natural that the entrance so nearly open should have attracted and held the whole of our attention. But now we saw that, provided the void we had found ran right round the chamber, we should be outside in a moment, and very probably able to make our way past the entrance without having to displace any earth. For the entrance was 2 feet wide, but the shaft was 3. And so it fell out. In less than 5 minutes, 6 more stones were out of the chamber's wall, and when I stepped through the new opening, there was the wall of the shaft 20 inches away. To breach this was very simple, yet took longer, I think, even than Mansell had expected, for we had ruined the crowbar and dared not work too fiercely for fear of spoiling the chisel or snapping the helve of the only hammer we had. But at last we had made an opening through which a man might pass. While Mansell and I had been working, Hanbury and Rowley had put what remained of the treasure into the bags and had fastened their mouths. This by Mansell's direction. "For," said he, "I know that a man can take nothing out of this world, but so long as he's in it, he may as well keep what he's got." And there we were all with him. For when you have staked your life on some adventure, it is a bitter business only to save your stake. So we escaped from the chamber into the shaft, taking the bags with us. There was a rope fastened to one of the bars. I suppose it had been bound there by the tanner to enable Ellis to make the ascent of the shaft, but it stood us in very good stead, for the steps were very irregular and covered with slime. It was at once arranged that we should descend one by one, for, rope or no, it was not a place to play tricks in, and if two used the rope together, one, by slipping, might bring the other down. I went first, dragging a bag behind me, and when I had reached the water, Hanbury followed me down. The water was roughly 1 foot from the top of the mouth of the shaft, and I could see a pale radiance which I knew for that of the moon. The air, too, was fresh, and chill and dank as it was because of the depth of the well, I can never describe the relief I found in breathing it, and I think it did more to refresh me body and soul than anything that had happened since Mansell and I had found the water at the foot of the coombe. So it was, I think, with us all. And of such, I suppose, is the way of Providence. For if ever 4 weary men had need of comfort, we needed it then. Except for a plank floating upon the water, the well was as empty of gear as a blown egg. I do not think we had counted on anything else. We had rather deliberately refrained from leaping, so to speak, until we were come to the ditch. But we had hoped desperately to find something, some rope, or scaffolding, which would have given us a chance, if not of scaling the walls, at least of rising with the water, and so avoiding the most miserable of deaths. But there was nothing at all. And though I went out with the torch, and getting astride of the plank, recklessly raked the walls for as far as the torch would light them, and that was some 30 feet up, I might have spared my labour, for they were as bare as my hand. Nothing. said Mansell as I came back to the shaft. I shook my head, and as they helped me ashore, Hanbury and I, between us, let fall the torch, and there was an end of that. For perhaps 2 minutes we stood with our eyes on the water, already full 4 inches higher than when I had seen it first 10 minutes before. Then I heard Mansell catch his breath. "What fools we are!" he cried. "We must be losing our minds. What was the use of this plank without 2 beams? They're not afloat, because they're locked in the niches, but I'll lay a monkey we find them 2 feet down." With that he dived, and after what seemed a long time, came up with one of the rafters which Carson and I had cut from the outhouse roof. In a moment I had the other, and together we set them in the niches, which were now 2 inches above the waterline. Then we laid the plank across them, and 5 minutes later, the four of us were standing upon the stage. We had had a struggle to bring the bags out of the shaft, for they were immensely heavy. Indeed, we had almost lost one, and this made us so uneasy that Hanbury went back to the shaft and cut a length from the rope, and with this lashed them loosely together, so that they could hang from a beam as a pair of saddlebags slung on the back of a horse. We did not sit down, for the plank was nearly awash, and very soon we should be able to raise the stage. But as I have said before, all the way up the well the niches lay 2 feet apart, and the beams being heavy, and we having nothing to stand on but only the water itself to buoy us up, we could not raise the rafters as much as 2 feet at a time, but must wait till the water had risen and make this distance less. So we stood in a row on the plank, and when the water was halfway to the calf of my leg, we raised the stage. Again we had a battle to save the bags, for to keep afloat ourselves during the transfer was almost as much as we could do, and swapping horses in midstream must be child's play compared with the struggle we had to raise ourselves and our baggage 20 inches above the flood. But at last it was over, and we were again on the plank, with nearly an hour before us before we must move again. Enforced inaction, I suppose, never helped anyone. But sitting there in the darkness, we had nothing to do but think. And when I set down my thoughts, I think I am revealing more or less what was in each of our minds. Our state was melancholy. We were as cold now as a short time before we had been hot. We had to chafe our fingers to prevent them from growing numb. Mansell was stripped to the waist, and we were all drenched and dripping and utterly worn out. Of succor from without, there was no hope at all. Carson was miles away, and Bell, if indeed he was not dead or captive, was holding the postern gate. The water was rising at the rate of 30 inches an hour, but this pace would not last for long, and 27 hours must elapse before we could climb above the high water mark. And if by some miracle we could endure so long, if before then the thieves had not returned to the well to find us waiting with the treasure, what then? Then we should still be 34 feet from the top. 34 feet. We had been confronted with 3 apparently insuperable steps. First we had been locked in the chamber, yet we had escaped. Then we had been trapped in the shaft, yet we had emerged. And now we were down in the well. That is to say, we had taken 2 of the steps, only to find that the 3rd was insuperable indeed. I will not say that there was no more spirit in us, but the figures with which we were faced would have daunted anyone. 27 hours of waiting, 25 several battles to raise the stage, and then 34 feet, which, unless some rope was dangling, we could not possibly scale. And when after 30 minutes Hanbury rose to his feet and said quietly, "I'm sorry, but I can't stand this," I think we all understood. "I'm going to try to climb up," he added gravely, "by means of the niches." "Steady, George," said Mansell, laying a hand on his arm. "The thing's impossible. No one in our condition could bring it off." "I'm going to try," said Hanbury. "It may be a chance in a million." "It isn't that," said I. "The niches come to an end 10 feet from the top." There was a long silence. and presently Hanbury sat down. And how long we sat still then, I cannot remember. But I know that all of a sudden, Rowley, who was sitting beside me, gave a great start, and then began to laugh like a man at a play. I laid hands upon him, for I thought he had lost his wits, but as soon as he spoke, I knew there was nothing to fear. "I'm sorry, sir, but it's like a clown in a ring. We'd sell our souls for a ladder, and we're sitting on one all the time." There was a moment's silence. Then, "Put it more clearly," said Mansell. "I believe I see what you mean." And that, I confess, was more than I could have said. "The beams, sir," said Rowley. "We can set them above one another, and then when we're all on the top one, pull out the one below and lift up that, and so on. I know there'll be 10 feet to go, sir, when we get to the top, but it's better than waiting until we can't wait no more." "It is indeed," said Mansell heartily. "Rowley, I give you best. And when we get out, as we shall, I'll thank you for saving my life." Then we all spoke at once and laughed and jested and clapped Rowley on the back, as if we were souls in a tavern and full of ale, instead of upon the brink of the most hazardous endeavour that ever four wretches made. Then Hanbury slipped off the plank into the water, and the rest of us straddled the beam over which the kit bags hung, and when he had freed the other, he gave it to us, and we fitted it into the niches 2 feet above. Happily, the beams were on edge, or they would not have borne our weight, but before 10 minutes were passed, we would have given a fortune to have had a third. Whether the plank would have helped us if we could have cut it down, I do not know, but the chisel we had left by the chamber, and there was a foot of water above the mouth of the shaft, and since it could not have carried us, though it might have served as a rail, we let it go. When George had climbed out of the water, before we went any further, we determined exactly the system by which we must go. "For," said Mansell, "if ever an exercise required a military precision, this is the stunt. We've only to make one mistake, and we shan't be in a position to make any more." The first thing which we had decided was to preserve the order in which we sat on the beam. Mansell was sitting at one end, and Hanbury at the other, each of them facing the wall. I was next to Mansell and facing the same way as he, and Rowley was next to George, and the bags hung in the middle between Rowley and me. And for the sake of convenience, I will do as Mansell did then, and number us off, so that he became number one, I became number two, Rowley became number three, and Hanbury number four. Numbers one and four were to move and take their seats on the beam we had just set up. They would then take hold of the niches 2 feet above to gain what stability they could. Number two and three would then move, and between them lift up the bags before moving up themselves. When they were up and in place, numbers two and three would lean down, keeping their balance by holding to one and four, and laying firm hold of the beam which was resting below, would draw it out of the niches and lift it up. They would bring it as far as their shoulders and there lay it down, when numbers one and four were to guide it home. That was our method. And though looking back, I think we might have done better, the devil was driving, and so it had to serve. Now, at first, all went like clockwork, and we must have climbed 26 feet before the depth below us began to make itself felt. I think we had all perceived that here was the serious drawback to Rowley's plan, for the highest niches were nearly 80 feet up, but it was so important that we should not lose heart that no one had even hinted that a fear of falling might presently supervene. Be that as it may, I know that all of a sudden the palms of my hands were dripping and I was afraid to move. Rowley and I between us had lifted the bags, and he had just taken his seat on the upper beam, but I dared not change my position, for I knew that if for one instant I were to release my hold, I should not be able to regain it, but must inevitably fall. By Mansell's direction, I waited, and after 2 or 3 minutes the attack seemed to pass away, but a few minutes later came another, and everything had to wait until I recovered my nerve. I suppose my head was the weakest, for I was the first to show fear, but presently Hanbury asked us to give him 2 minutes' grace, and when at length he moved and I turned to lift the bags, Rowley began to tremble, and 5 more minutes went by before he could play his part. From then on, the ascent was a nightmare. If we had had a third beam, it would not have been so bad, but the rafters were very narrow, and to bestride the upper without any handheld above to help us to keep our seats sometimes required such an effort as we could scarcely make. Again, it would have been better if we had not had to look down, but the dark motion of the water was constantly catching the eye and reminding us of the doom which one false movement would evoke. My hands ran so fast with sweat that I was continually fearful of letting fall the rafter which Rowley and I were to raise, and once, when my end was free, but his would not leave its knit, I had to let go of Mansell and put down my other hand, because if I had not done so, the beam must have slipped from my grasp. We dared not rest, if for no other reason, because the depth below us seemed to feed upon delay, for so often as we waited for someone to recover his nerve, the bare idea of moving seemed to become monstrous, and the renewal of the struggle a hazard we could not take. With this increasing horror came other fears, and though we spoke hardly at all, I think we imagined vain things. Now a beam seemed to be bending, and now insecurely lodged. We supposed one beam to have fallen, and saw ourselves trapped in mid-air. We wondered if one of us fell, what the others would do. Behind all, the 10 nicheless feet to which we must come rose like some sinister cliff where the wave of endeavour should be stayed. But while these apprehensions were transient, the height at which we were working was always there, and what was worse, growing more obtrusive with every move we made. Yet we went on, somehow, making our way up the well, building our ladder as we went. I do not remember feeling weary, but only most stiff and sore. And indeed, I find it astonishing that we managed so well as we did, for before we had located the chamber, we were almost dead beat, and when we were sitting on the plank, I was so much exhausted that if I had fallen off, I am sure I should have sunk like a stone. Yet though we were not sprightly, we moved with a will. And I think it must have been our nerves that kept us going, for I do not believe that we had any physical energy left. After a long time, we could make out the top of the well, for the light of the moon had vanished, and it was very dark. And with this, a new dread came to plague us, namely that the thieves would return before we were up. And at times we made sure we had seen the flash of a torch, and at others that Rose Noble was waiting and only letting us carry the treasure up. We had moved, I think, 36 times, but I cannot be sure, and I had just taken my seat when Mansell spoke. "This niche is my last," said he. "Hanbury, do you say the same?" After a moment, "Yes," said Hanbury. "Very good," said Mansell, and then to me, "Carry on." So, for the last time, Rowley and I withdrew and lifted the beam, and Mansell and Hanbury guided it into place. Then Mansell stood up and straddled it, and ran his hands over the wall, and Hanbury did the same. But neither spoke, and presently both sat down. "William," said Mansell, looking up, "are you sure we're still 10 feet down?" "Certain," said I. "I've marked it many a time." "Well," said he with a sigh, "I'd rather be 10 feet down than 34. Can anyone see the chain?" We could make out the windlass, but no one could see the chain. "Let's hope it's dangling," said Mansell, 3 or 4 feet away. With that, he and Hanbury descended and sat on the lower beam. Then they withdrew the upper and gave it to me, and while they and Rowley crouched down, I turned the timber crosswise in the hope, if it was there, of striking the chain. But I encountered nothing, and after a moment or two I was thankful to give it up and to hear it slide back into place. Then for a while we sat silent, continually gazing upward at the rim of the well. And then at last I perceived the only way. And wet with sweat as I was when I saw it, I broke out again. But it was the only way, and after a little discussion, we made the attempt. Mansell and Rowley bestrode the upper beam, this time facing each other instead of towards the wall. I stood between them, in the middle of the lower beam. When they were ready, I put my hands on their shoulders and mounted the upper beam. And when I was standing upright, I let myself fall forward against the wall. This was but 3 feet away. At once Hanbury mounted behind me and stepped up onto my shoulders. This brought his head to the level of the rim of the well, and an instant later he was up and within the redoubt. In a flash, he was at the windlass and had let go a length of chain. Then he locked the windlass, and pulling the chain in by hand, lowered it so that it hung between my face and the wall. I seized it easily enough, and 1 minute later I was out of the well. Then we hauled up the bags, and Rowley, and finally Mansell himself. And when he was up, with one consent, we all lay down on the ground, and no one of us moved or spoke for 5 minutes or more. To tell the truth, we were past speaking. And I cannot set down our emotions, because even at this distance of time, I can find no words which can tell our gratitude and relief. So we all surmounted the third insuperable step, and thanks to Mansell and Rowley, found ourselves risen from the dead. For Mansell brought us into the well, and Rowley taught us how to climb up. And though they both made much of what Hanbury and I had done, I am afraid the depth of the well lent our performance a glamour which it did not deserve. The redoubt was deserted. For this we were thankful, yet it quickened our concern for Tester and Bell, and when I remembered Rose Noble's way with a hostage, I felt uneasy indeed. We were all of us streaming with sweat. So Mansell took a shirt and a jersey, which he found hanging up, and each of us took some clothing against the cool of the night. Then we passed into the meadow and took to the woods. We dared not go by the castle, but bore towards the shrine, presently turning left-handed across the road of approach. So we came down to the river, which we made at a point not very far from where Mansell had hidden the boat. To find this took some minutes, for although we could see the dawn coming, it was still very dark. But at length I fell into a gully, and there it was. Then Mansell gave Hanbury Ellis's pistol, which he had taken from the body before he descended the shaft. "You and Rowley," he said, "stay here and hang on to the bags, while Chandos and I take the boat and scull to the chute. What we shall find, I know no more than you, but whatever happens, I think you must both sit tight, for I know I'm too tired to swim, and we've been close enough to drowning for the last 3 hours. And as soon as it's light, I think I should dry that pistol as best you can." With that, we launched the boat, and at once I bent to the sculls. When we came to the chute, we listened. But except for the lap of the water, we could hear no manner of sound. Then Mansell took his pistol, and withdrawing the magazine, took out the ammunition and wiped it dry. There was a round in the chamber, and he dried that as well. Then he reloaded the weapon, and when it was quite to his liking, he put up his hand and rang the bell. For a moment or two we sat waiting. Then the flap was withdrawn. Now, whether it was Bell who had withdrawn it or one of the thieves, we could not possibly tell. If it was one of the thieves, now was the moment to enter, as Rose Noble had done. But whoever it was did not let down the ladder, and Mansell dared not demand it, because at once his speech would give him away. Suddenly, to our great joy, we heard Tester let out the grunt which he kept for matters suspicious, whose claim to be passed in silence had yet to be proved. "Bell," said Mansell at once.
"Sir?"
said Bell.
"Where's Rose Noble?"
"In the oubliette, sir. There's four of them there, and the innkeeper's pulled up the rope, so they can't get out."
"But the postern?"
"Carson's holding that, sir.
When you didn't come, I thought I'd best bring him here."
"Well done indeed," said Mansell. "And now let down the ladder and I'll come up." Then he gave me his pistol and told me to pick up the others and row them across the river, treasure and all. "And then come back here," said he, "as soon as you can, for this is the last lap, and between you and me, I've a fancy to win the race." With that, he went up the ladder and I sculled back to the others as fast as I could. Hanbury and Rowley could hardly believe my news, and indeed to me it seemed almost too good to be true, for that Bell and Tester should be safe, smacked of the supernatural, but that Rose Noble should have permitted himself to be snared was almost inconceivable. I was back at the chute in 10 minutes,
and at once Bell lowered the bucket full of our clothes. Then he let down food and wine, and lastly a medley of things, arms and paper and money and Lockhart's Life of Scott. Finally he descended and proposed to row me across and then himself to return for Mansell and Carson. But I had him across the river before he had got his clothes, and when he had unloaded the boat, I sculled back for the last time. I arrived to find Carson throwing down our last coil of rope, and after a little he descended with Tester under his arm. Almost at once the rope ladder fell into the water, and an instant later Mansell slid down the chute. He would not enter the boat, but laid hold of the painter and bade me bend to the oars. So soon as we were ashore, we sank the boat, and 2 minutes later we all set out for the culvert, bearing our treasure with us like men in a fairy tale. The dawn was up, but we held to the road, for to make our way across country was beyond our power. As it was, we lurched and staggered, and once I fell asleep walking, and taking no note of a bend, fell into the ditch. Yet Mansell drove us on. "For," said he, "I'm not going to be caught at the post. There's the postern and the chute and the river between them and us, but four of us are no better than dead men, and I couldn't hit Rose Noble at 7 feet. And there you are. I'm sorry to spoil your outlook, but we've got to be in France before sunset, and there's quite a long way to go." At last we came to the culvert. There we left the rifles, bestowing them under the arch, and then, without more ado, we all climbed into the rolls, and Carson drove us to Villach as fast as he could. There we only waited to take up the second car, and Bell was set to drive this, because after Carson he was the least fatigued. 10 miles short of Salzburg we stopped, and when we had done what we could to order our appearance, we emptied the rolls' toolbox and packed within so much of the treasure as we could make it hold. It was a capacious coffer, but when it was full there still remained a good deal. Most of this we hid in the tire of one of the two spare wheels, and what was still left we concealed about ourselves. All this because of the customs, for we knew very well that if it was found at a frontier that we were laden with jewels, we should be certainly stopped, and those in authority informed. And here, for the first time, I perceived that though we had lifted the treasure, we stood in imminent danger of losing every ounce. For if once its existence came to the knowledge of the state, all the resources of the law would be employed to prevent 6 foreigners from abstracting so considerable a fortune. This peril shocked me so much that I besought Mansell to wait and let us dispose the treasure in some less conspicuous place. But he would not listen. "I dare not wait," said he, "because of Rose Noble. I'm not afraid of him, because now we've had some sleep. But I don't want a brush with him in a public place. Whatever the outcome was, explanations would have to be made, and we're not in a position to explain. Nobody is, when he's carrying stuff like this. As for the customs, we've as good a chance there today as we should have next week. I shan't enjoy the passage, but it's got to be made. As far as the toolbox is concerned, I'll give you an excellent rule. If you've something to hide, always hide it in the most obvious place. And now don't worry. If you can't go to sleep, look inexpressibly bored. And please try not to perspire. Perspiration is the emblem of an uneasy mind." If that was a true saying, the officials who dealt with us were an unobservant lot, for while they examined the rolls, the sweat ran down my face. But Mansell paid the dues with an injured air, and after a little delay, they let us pass. So we entered Germany, and at 5:30 that evening we came to France. And here I thought all was over, for they turned us out of the car and took up the cushions and carpet and opened the petrol tank. They did not open the toolbox, because they saw Mansell do that. I saw him do it too, and thought he was out of his mind. He took out one of the rubbers with which we had covered the treasure, and then put a foot on the toolbox and started to dust his shoes, talking politics all the time with the Frenchman in charge, and becoming so engrossed in his discourse that the search had been done, and we were back in the car before he had finished his dusting and put his rubber away. And when later we spoke of the matter with bated breath, he merely observed that prevention was better than cure. "But you must have been worried," cried Hanbury. "Worried?" said Mansell. "I think it took a year off my life." And there You have Jonathan Mansell. Master of many things, he was especially master of himself. His self-control was so perfect that those who knew him best could no more read his heart than they could look through a plate of armor of proof. Add to this that he could think twice as swiftly as other men, and you will see the disadvantage at which his enemies stood. When we were in any trouble, because he was wiser, he saw more clearly than we the depth of the risk we ran. Yet he was always the coolest, the most confident, the most matter of course. With it all, he was never secretive. All his movements were gentle, yet he had the strength of two men. He was most unassuming and generous, yet was plainly revered wherever he went. I never knew, till long after, that when he became lame as the result of a wound, he lost his balance, and so his head for heights, and that from that time on, it troubled him to so much as look down from a balcony onto a garden below. Yet on that awful night, he came up the great well and gave no indication then or at any time of the agony he must have suffered from this terrible thorn in the flesh. At Strasbourg, we turned south. And when we were deep in the country, we took a little by-road which led to a wood. There we spent the night. And at 8 o'clock the next evening, we reached Dieppe. So I came back to England the way I had come some 70 days before, with a dog collar in my pocket and my heart in my mouth. And here, before I go any further, I will set down Bell's tale. He had heard the trap open, for he had not been asleep, and he and Tester had at once withdrawn to the ramp. No bomb had been thrown, but four men had at once descended into the oubliette. One of these was Rose Noble, and another the tanner, for he had passed close to the postern, and Bell had observed the odour which hung about him. Almost at once, they had all gone into the shaft. But they were a long time gone, and before they came back, someone else had descended and followed them in. Suddenly, Bell had heard the unmistakable cry of a man in terror of death. This came from the shaft. At once a spout of German had burst from the trap, and since he could hear two voices, Bell knew that they must be those of the tanner's allies. Their tones were plainly apprehensive, and again they repeated the name Johann. And at last Bell gathered that the cry must have come from the tanner, and that the two at the trap were suspecting foul play. Sure enough, when the thieves returned, as they presently did, and Rose Noble commanded the landlord to draw him up, the latter demanded Johann, and when the thieves sought to bluff him, made it plain in pitiful English that he and the tanner's brother would take no one of them up until they heard Johann's voice. Now, what in the world we were doing, Bell could not tell, but supposed we were holding the chamber instead of the shaft. And since, if they could not get up, the thieves were certain to try to force the postern, he decided to summon Carson to help him to hold the ramp. He therefore whipped down to the gallery, and opening two of the windows, turned on our electric light, and then sped back to the postern to witness a turbulent scene, the thieves roaring orders and threats, and the innkeeper and his companion hurling down taunts and abuse. Then somebody fired at the trap, and at once, as though in answer, the rope came tumbling down onto the stile. Then Rose Noble had turned upon Punter and rent him for leaving the trap, and Punter had cursed Rose Noble for taking the tanner's life. But Rose Noble declared with an oath that the tanner had hoaxed them. "He's done in Ellis," he said, "and the bags are down in the shaft. He was meaning to box us here and then go back with his fellows and pouch the lot, and if we don't get out of this hole, those other two black-blooded rats'll have it yet." "But where's the Willies?" cried Job. The question confounded Bell, but appeared to sober the thieves, for at once they lowered their voices, clearly believing that we were all in the ramp, and presumably fearing that we should leave by the chute and make for the well. Presently Job had approached and endeavoured to force the postern, and while he was so engaged, Bell shot him dead. At once the other three had retired to the shaft, from which Bell fully expected that we should soon drive them out. But when presently Carson arrived, yet there was no sign of our coming, he could not think what had happened, and began to fear very much that some accident had occurred. When Carson heard his story, he had at once decided that Bell must have taken some rest, and that if in 3 hours' time we had not appeared, they must force their way into the shaft to see what the trouble might be. But before that time had expired, we had come to the chute. For several times the thieves had approached the postern, but I suppose no one of them was minded to give his life for the other two, for a frontal attack alone could have been successful, and that they did not make. In the hope of reducing their number, Carson had held his fire as long as he dared, but though he had wounded Punter, they gave him no other chance. So in the end, Rose Noble's astonishing instinct overleaped itself. For had he not slain the tanner, finding the fellow guilty of something he had not done, he must, I think, have had the treasure and four of us into the bargain. There is little more to be told. On the way from New Haven to London, we stopped in a lonely place and put the treasure back into the canvas bags. And when we reached Cleveland Row, we carried it up and laid it in Mansell's flat. And there, for the first time, we saw what it was we had won. The spoil was that of a robber of high estate. There was nothing common, and except for a small bag of gold, no coinage at all. There were jewels of all descriptions, and many loose, precious stones. There were brooches and clasps and circlets. There were cups, and the hilts of poniards studded with gems. There were two crucifixes, and a monstrance, and the crook of a pastoral staff, the presence of which, had he been charged with sacrilege, Axel the Red might have found it hard to explain. There was a golden chessboard, with ruby and emerald chessmen as fine as you please. There was a scourge, the seven cords of which were loaded with seven diamonds the size of full-grown grapes. There were jewelled dice and bracelets and 18 or 20 rings. There were images and girdles and a golden hunting horn. But most lovely of all was a triptych, whose three little sacred pictures were done like stained glass windows, only with precious stones. When we had examined it thoroughly, we packed it all into a plate chest and lodged it at Mansell's bank. And there, I suppose, our adventure came to an end. Most of the treasure we sold, but Mansell, Hanbury, and I each kept some one of the gems. They made me take the triptych because the secret of Wagensberg had been bequeathed to me, and I have lent it to a museum because, to be honest, I dare not house it myself. For what we sold, we received £900,000. "Which is very much less," said Mansell, "than what it is worth. But that cannot be helped, for I never was any good in the counting-house, and from what I've seen of you two, you're worse than I. And indeed, for my part, if I had been told it was worth but 500,000, I should have been none the wiser and perfectly content. Of this huge sum, Mansell, Hanbury, and I took each 2/9 for himself, and Carson, Rowley, and Bell received 1/9 apiece." To my great surprise, when Bell had been given his check, he said that if I was content to keep him, he had no wish to leave my service. When I pointed out that he was now a man of means, he said that, for his part, that did not alter the case, and since Hanbury and I were proposing to share an estate in the country, I told him to take a holiday and report to me in 3 weeks' time. Both George and I found it hard to part with Mansell, and when the latter suggested that we should come down to Hampshire and spend a week with him there, we were only too glad to accept. And there, in the midst of the New Forest, he brought us back to the world. For our doings of the last 2 months had thrown our focus out, and when we looked upon the future, this seemed intolerably grey. But Mansell pointed the virtue of quiet enjoyment, maintaining that only those who knew the quality of peace could, when the moment came, taste the full flavour of battle. "For," said he, "for the last 2 months we have been against the peace, and that is a condition which is all very well for a time, but if it is too much prolonged, will surely lose its sweetness, and what is infinitely worse, will sour the years that are left in the cellar of life." So he did us an enduring service, for but for that week in Hampshire, I do not think that either George Hanbury or I would have ever settled down, but having the means to do so, would have gone out to rove the world in search of more excitement, and so have dropped substance for a shadow and thrown our birthrights away. As it is,
I can now look back upon those 70 days as a man regards some picture, the contemplation of which never fails to bring him infinite delight. For they stand clean out of a quiet, orderly existence, and by the contrast, gain immeasurably. Their burden is as vivid today as it was that sunshiny morning when we unloaded the toolbox not far from the London Road. The murder of the Englishman and the quiet contempt of his prophecy that Ellis would come to grief. The level crossing and the fierce pounding of my heart as we sat awaiting the train. The courtyard of Wagensburg and Mansell against the lime tree with Rose Noble stretched at his feet. The ear-splitting crash of the bomb and Mansell's steady voice calling the roll. The heat of the closed car's engine scorching my back. The smell of tanning and Tester's menacing bark. Rose Noble's weight upon me and his heavy breathing as he set out to take my life. Our last stupendous effort to reach the chamber, and Ellis dead and staring against the bars. And then our terrible battle with that most jealous of wardens, the great well. The memory of these things I find as valuable as my share of the treasure itself, and I doubt if ever a man was so well paid for undertaking the care of a masterless dog. The latter is with me always, and I think her life is happy. I have called her Rafter, for as the name of a dog, the word does well enough, while it will always mean a great deal to me. And here I may say that Tester was more fortunate than she, for he never went into quarantine, but instead into the toolbox of the second car, to emerge upon Ashdown Forest with, to judge from his spirits, a new lease of life. But then, he was a hardened smuggler, and had cheated the customs this way a dozen times.
That was Alan Rickman reading Blind Corner by Dawnford Yeats. We do hope that you've enjoyed listening to this audiobook, and if you'd like to listen to further titles, please contact your local library.